Juan.
Hello, Space Latinos. Welcome to episode fucking 10. My God.
Yeah.
10 out of 10.
This was just an experiment. Like, I was really just using this as a testing platform to see if this rule set worked. I modified along the way. Case in point, you just got Expecto Patronum, and I changed the power output just a little bit. Or the power usage, therefore affecting the output, therefore affecting the usiveness of said spell. Anyway, you got Protego, Jeffrey.
I did.
Y'all got Expecto Patronads. And I have a...
Expecto Patronads.
I have a special little secret for both of you.
Oh goodness.
I have held off this because you guys were in the middle of a boss dungeon.
Okay.
And either you guys had gotten right to it, or were in the middle of it,
mm-hmm.
and now you're beyond it.
Right.
Happy birthday to both of you.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
You can pick one of two presents.
But you already gave us presents.
I mean in the game.
Oh.
By the way, both of our birthdays collectively were like 2.5 weeks ago.
Yes.
I'm just... It's okay.
Shush!
One right after the other.
Actually, I think it was 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, well, we skipped a week because somebody had a meeting that got canceled.
Yeah.
And then one of us went to the theater.
Very inconvenient, by the way, if anyone's listening who was in charge of putting on that meeting. Anyway.
All right, your gift can either be the choice of one of three potions or another spell of your choice.
This is really hard.
I know.
It has to be a spell, or it could be anything that an ability point can get you.
An ability point.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
An ability point or a random of three potions or a choice of three potions?
I'm going to give you the choice of one of three potions.
Okay.
This is a terrible choice.
Do we have access to knowing what the potions are before choosing?
Since it's your birthdays, yeah. Let's do
that.
You're such a pushover.
Don't.
Okay, no.
Don't ever.
You don't have access.
As
potions are AP.
As a recovering pushover, don't ever call people.
Oh, man, that was great. You know, that was enough of a birthday present right there. That was great.
Cool. All right, Jenny, what would you like?
I would like... Do I get to choose from potions or is it random?
No, it's not random. So if you choose potions, I will then, because of him, I will then tell you what three there are, and you'll pick one of the three.
I have to say potions because it's, I just love potions.
Okay. What is your choice before I list the three potions and therefore ruin this?
Gregory
would
want a potion.
Well, I'm no longer interested in the three potions because I don't know what the three potions are, so I'm going to skip the three potions to get the ability point.
All right. Good luck. Great.
Better pick something that benefits the team.
Efficiency, thank you. Oh, you already knew that was going to get efficiency.
Your choices are...
I already got it.
Felix Felicis.
Oh, shit.
Which gives you, with 10 minutes of game time, of pure luck.
What?
Tastes of amaretto and lemon.
What?
Polyjuice potion. Sickly thick gray potion that resembles liquid cement. The maker must add the hair, fingernails, teeth, or the like... of whoever they're wishing to duplicate. Whoever drinks this fully prepared potion will copy the appearance and voice of whoever they are prepared to mimic. This potion has been described as tasting like curdled milk with hair. And three, Veritas Serum, the truth potion, often used by the Ministry of Magic during interrogations of convicted murderers. This potion cannot be resisted by willpower alone. The consumers of this potion are forced to tell the truth to any question posed to them. Wizards and witches become fearful after this potion's creation due to the rumored simplicity of its recipe and its flavorlessness. It tastes of nothing.
That is creepy. Yes. I did not know that's the description of that, and that is even more disturbing than the idea of it alone. And I don't like that potion, and I don't think my character would either.
Real quick, while you
as
make your choice.
As tempting as that is, for future use, yeah, what?
I just want to say, I was mistaken, and I don't have deep reserves yet. So I got deep reserves.
Sweet.
So I got 8 more MP, which actually brings me to an even 50 HP and 50 MP, and my OCD is just shaking right now. Like,
you should have gotten both of those at once.
It's so tantalized.
Cool. Deep reserves. So deep.
So deep.
Anyway.
He was making a wanking motion. I looked at him with wide eyes and describing this to you, reader.
Wanking.
I don't know how you could be so deep while you're wanking.
It's like the name of an elf.
Wanky.
Wanking.
Wanky.
Sorry.
Bring me a cup of tea, Wanky.
So you have Polyjuice Potion, Felix Felicius.
Felicis, sorry. And Veritas Serum.
And Veritas Serum. Wow.
Do not help her.
I'm just like...
And Aaron's mind would be made up in the same way, I think.
What you got?
I want the Felix.
Of course you do. Felix Felicis. Yes. The tiny little bottle is about as tall as your, and thick as your pinky. It is so tiny because it will only work for 10 minutes. And it is only one use. Once you open it and swallow, it's done. It's not like,
but that was like a whisper. Is it 1 minute?
No. 10 minutes. Done.
That's badass.
What do you mean I can't have like micro uses of it?
Give a little bit to Ron or whoever.
I'm going to ask, knowing full well that you can just ignore me with this, please don't use it at the very end of the boss fight of the entire campaign. Because then you could just walk up to them and go, die.
At any time within that last battle?
You're the DM.
Really use it whenever you want to. I'm not going to cut you off and say, it explodes,
I mean,
die.
I wouldn't want to do that. And two, how would I know in the last battle?
And you might not. So really just use it whenever you want to.
Okay. It's for if we're in a really bad situation, like it would have been really nice during this whole last predicament, I think.
Yeah.
But anyway, cool.
All right. You guys, you appear through the portal of fire and flames. And you roll hither and thither across the feathery carpet of Dumbledore's office. You land next to the unconscious, bleeding body of Sean Thornwood, your enemy, who cast very mean spells at your bodies.
Whoa, enemy is a bit of a strong word.
Was also wearing blackface, by
the way. Sean Thornwood is the wizard douchebag who trapped you in his family's manor in a months-long time loop, in which was all explained in the last episode. If you don't remember, go and watch and listen to the last episode.
Not Briar Cain.
Was not Briar Cain,
but for
some inexplicable reason, which is purely explicable, he was impersonating Briar Cain. All right, both of y'all, give me a D4.
Two.
Two.
Ooh, okay.
Twinsies. Twosy twinsies.
You look about Dumbledore's office. There is no one there. Mm-hmm. What do you do? To answer the question that was posed before session, by the way, just to get to it now, Alohomora, Wingardium Leviosa, anything that you acquired, anything that you learned, any experience gained, any memories, you keep with you.
Oh.
That whole experience is with you.
Is with me, or with us, and is genuine.
But the two of you only remember the one you succeeded.
Right. Yeah, we don't remember all the iterations that happened, because that would be odd.
We can mark all those spells.
It's not like The Good Place when Chidi gets all the millions of instances of his life. Yeah, it's not like that.
I should probably watch that.
Such a good show! Alright. It's so good! So what do you do?
All right. Well, I'm happy because we have spells and such.
Which ones? It was Alohomora and Wingardium Leviosa. Did we get any others?
You were able to experimentally and successfully cast Accio once or twice. Is not permanent. Do not add it. Don't do it.
Okay, but I can add the other two?
But she had fun with it.
Yeah, you had fun with it once or twice. But that is it.
I did have a question about Wingardium Leviosa, because I don't think it's mentioned as a sustained ability.
Damn it. It's a sustained ability.
Okay. I didn't have it marked that way.
It should be. I can change that. Again, this is all purely experimental and not finished whatsoever, just like B&D itself. It's constantly changing.
Yes, it is. I know. I just wanted to give you a look. Like,
just like the hidden arcana from 5e or whatever it's called.
The hidden what?
The arcana, or the found arcana. So that whenever they add another class or something, because they just want to, like the alchemist or the artificer or whatever they did. I'm going to add that right now. Sustained.
Alchemist is freaking sweet.
Can you explain what sustained means?
Sustained means that if you cast a spell and go Wingardium Leviosa, you are maintaining that thing's flight constantly.
Okay.
Until you deactivate it.
Many turns or however you want, however long you want.
Okay.
With it being sustained, I should really increase its MP cost, actually.
Up to you.
I'm going to increase it to 4. Might even increase it higher than that, but let's go with 4.
Okay.
Alright.
So we're increasing it to 4. It's a sustainability, got it. Also, important note on sustainability is, I think, just in case if you don't know, activating sustainability is a minor action.
Mm-hmm.
And deactivating, saying you just want to drop them, like, because you're holding them up or whatever. Like when I was Wingardium Leviosa-ing you up the manor, at any point I could have just dropped you as an instant action.
I would have been really pissed.
It would have been stupid. But
so
I could have.
Cool.
I could have betrayed you and be like, hi, I have broken legs, and I just ran away from you.
Down the road and trigger the night bus. Just leave you.
Leave. Pursue a life.
What would have happened if I'd chosen to persuade him to do that instead?
So we have. I did answer this, but I'm not sure if this was actually in recording.
Mm.
You asked me about the night
bus
before.
I don't remember!
In order to get out of the ring of effect that time stone had, it would have taken you a couple of hours to walk out of its ring, and by that point you still probably would not have reached town. So it really would have been up to you. It would have been a determination of how far would Aaron be willing to really travel based on a chance. Because if you had gone out to the road right outside the manor and gone, night bus! Nothing would have happened.
Interesting.
But
okay. So to keep going in this session, not to get sidetracked anymore, I know that Newt's been here, and so I'm actually curious if there's actually, I'm sorry, this is more of a question you should be asking. I'm so sorry, Aaron, but do I notice any creatures or anything living that's currently residing in his office, like the phoenix,
right,
or if there's anything
here
in cages?
Fox is in his perch, yes. He's on his perch, not in his perch.
Yeah.
He's not meta, like, crossing.
Is he sleeping or staring at us?
He is weakedly, like, one eye open, like, looks over.
I say hi.
He's quite aged at this period, so he's not lively.
He's ready to do his molting thing.
Interesting.
Not quite there, but he's getting there.
Interesting that Fox doesn't seem alarmed by an injured person and
he's used to it.
Just popping into existence.
He's used
if he could talk, he'd be like, you'd be surprised what comes into this room.
I would like to,
I
would like to politely ask the portraits where Dumbledore is.
They all look down at you, bewildered, and several of them run out of frame.
Oh, thanks. Great.
A couple of them look at each other and then look back down at you, look across at everyone else who are still constantly staring at you, and those two remaining say to you, do you not know what's going on in the castle right now?
No.
We did appear here 7 months. 7 months?
Yeah.
7 months later.
You left in October, appeared in May.
We've been trapped in a time loop, my good sirs. So no, don't know anything.
The one who spoke looks across to the other, that's like his partner or friend maybe, across the room from you guys, so you can actually like see this tennis match of a conversation. And he looks over and he says, Dumbledore was right. He was actually right.
Isn't he always?
I'm going to elaborate on what Aaron told the portraits and go into a little more detail, explaining that the time loop has warped us and kept us outside of regular life for roughly 7 months, and that we are no longer, quote, missing, as I imagine that the wizarding world would have labeled us as, and that my best friend Franz decided to stay behind, and that he may actually be lost forever because he decided to stay within the time loop, at least temporarily. I don't know how long he was planning. We were in a bit of a rush to get out.
And we've got this guy who's,
is Sean Thornwood, very bloodied. He turned on us. He turned on House Gryffindor. He had intent to commit Slytherin genocide. And he was the one responsible for the time loop, to my knowledge.
And the beasties.
I divulged all the information, disclosed everything.
Yeah.
You have a rapt audience as those who remained in their portraits stare down at you. Some pull up popcorn bags and start eating as they're watching your display everything that's going on. And Aaron the whole time is just like, yeah. Yeah,
oh,
that
come
too.
On, I
yeah.
help.
And you help contribute adding facts like, and I threw myself out a window. And you guys tell quite a vivid story. And eventually when you're done, Armando Dippet says to you, this is all very interesting. However, maybe we should go and get, actually, Dumbledore, because he can actually do something, because we're just portraits.
Uh-oh.
Right. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was going to ask, what's going on?
There we go. Thank you.
Oh, right.
Right
you
now.
Don't know anything.
No.
The students have been evacuated.
Again?
As of when?
What's happened now?
As of this morning. Each house has been evacuated out to Hogsmeade for mass... apparition, I suppose, because I don't go out there. I'm a portrait!
Mass apparition?
Mass apparition back home. To London. Oh. To Scotland Hills. Whatever. I don't know the world. I'm a portrait. So, they're gone. And the teachers stayed, I believe.
Do you know why they're being evacuated?
Yes.
Can you tell me why they're being evacuated?
I'm not sure I'm allowed to.
Mm. Oh. Is Armando Dippet, as you said, have any significance? Does that name ring any bells as a historical figure or anything like that? Or is it just a little bit of flavor that you called him or
yes.
named him?
He was a former headmaster.
He was the headmaster prior to Dumbledore.
Uh-huh.
He was headmaster when that shit with Hagrid happened.
So he's...
Yeah.
Got it. So he is going to be very by the book in terms of what he can and cannot say.
Yeah, that is
yeah.
kind of what we got from his character.
Yeah.
From what I remember.
Weak-chinned compared to Dumbledore.
Okay. Would you be so kind as to be able to get Dumbledore, or would it be faster if we were to leave and find him ourselves?
The portraits are going to find him. That's what they do.
Honestly, it may be better if you just go downstairs. He's probably on the first floor, making sure that nobody else lingered. They may be on their way.
I don't think we should leave because this guy might
yeah.
pick up any minute.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But, you know, an added benefit to Expecto Patronum is that it can deliver messages.
It can. You're right. But how does that work if we're not in battle? Like the MP?
You may cast. And burn the MP. would you mind telling the microphone what animal?
A dragon.
A dragon. Do you have any preferred breed of dragon?
Oh, I think an Eastern dragon would be fun.
Eastern dragon? Like the Chinese fireball?
Because
most
like
of
that's right in Harry Potter land, it has to be one of their dragons.
There's the Norwegian Ridgeback, the Hungarian Horntail.
I want an opal eye. It's pretty.
Aha!
It's
yes.
pretty.
All right.
Yay!
Oh, what region is that from? The opal eye. Oh my god.
Oh, I don't know.
Don't tell me. Don't tell me. Don't tell me. Don't. Opal eye.
But I won't tell.
Alright, so what do you guys do?
I'm going to cast my Patronus.
It's not in here.
Antipodean Opali.
Oh, that's why. It's hard to pronounce.
Antipodean Opali.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to cast Expecto Patronum.
For the first time in your life.
And go have it go find Dumbledore.
Dumbledore.
Isn't that so pretty? Oh, it's pretty. So pretty in the Wizards Unite game. It's like a mother of pearl.
Mm. Yeah. I love it. Well, all the color and everything doesn't really matter because it comes up as like a ghosty, like
it is
white,
a ghostly
silvery
white, but
image.
Still,
right?
Yeah. That's the formation.
Hmm. That's cool. That's cool.
7 is what I rolled for that.
Okay. What message do you send through the Patronus?
Is there a limit?
Gregory and Aaron have returned with. Should I name him?
Oh, you want to say Sean?
Sean.
It doesn't really matter. He's going to find out.
We're stuck in time loop. ASAP, come help to your office.
I that's why I was asking if there was a limit. I was like...
Willpower check, please.
Okay.
I was like, is it like a short phrase, or could you send like a whole paragraph or something?
I think it's like a couple phrases. Usually it's like one in the movies, the ministry has fallen, blah, 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 blah,
yeah.
And that's all it says. Oh, 18.
Wonderful. So that willpower was determining whether or not you actually formulated the depiction of the person you wanted it to be sent to accurately. And with 18, you're like, Dumbledore. And it swooshes through the room,
so cool.
Roaring through
so
the
cool.
air, and it whooshes under the door and out of sight. And you're like, I'm cool now.
By the way, while all of this is going on, and since we've been to his office, I want to make a point to say that I never keep one, or that I always keep at least one eye on Sean Thornwood.
He has not moved a single centimeter.
Good. Yeah, I don't want to like accidentally be all like... Something happens. Yeah, no. Something happens.
Can
like,
do we have anything we can cast on him to keep him in that state?
I don't think it's necessary because he's literally so fucked up that even if he woke up, he would literally be like,
curb stop him, accidentally
yeah.
kill him.
I just want to make sure that nothing like scoops him up magically and he's like, aha, I got away or something stupid.
While you are waiting.
Not to say that would be stupid, right?
Sure. While you're waiting, I'm going to control your characters a little bit.
Sure.
And both on your own, while waiting for your headmaster to return to his office, you look around the room, and there are newspaper clippings. There's old magazines. There's instruments of magical means that you do not know their purpose or origin. Random poofs of smoke randomly appear from certain pipes or certain pieces that you don't get. There's a cabinet that's slightly ajar with a silvery gleam coming out of it, and you're like, that must be nothing.
Oh, wait.
You look over, and there's an observatory up some stairs. Underneath is a loft where you imagine he sleeps. His grand, giant desk is covered in papers.
Can I look in the pensieve? See if there's anything
what
in
pensieve?
There? Oh. I wouldn't know what it is.
Give me a natural d20, please, to see if Aaron...
This is what this bitch would do.
Are you referring to Aaron or
yes.
yourself?
14.
You idly make your way over to the fireplace at the same time as Gregory makes his way back to the live fire, admiring, saddeningly, that the flames are a vivid orange. And therefore, the way back is completely sealed. And you know that the flu powder left in that little tiny pouch is certainly not enough to open the portal again. The way is shut. You open the cabinet door, and the eerie glow of the silver liquid gas that is the pensieve emanates around the room. And it's slightly colder, suddenly, in the room. And Armando Dippet says, what are you doing? Close that right now!
Okay, alright. Damn it.
5 points for... Damn it, I can't do it anymore.
I thought it'd be fun to try. Maybe you as a DM had something in there.
You don't even know what's in there.
Okay, alright.
Well, just because Armando Dippet is yelling at you doesn't mean you can't do it anyway.
No, but
not that Gregory would want you to or anything. I'm too busy looking at orange flames.
You can control your character.
Okay, cool.
God, would she do it anyway?
I turn around because Aaron's not next to me anymore.
I think I want to look in there anyway.
What you see is whispers of time that you do not recognize because you were not here. You see Dumbledore going through the halls, going through the classrooms, pushing children hither and thither, not forcefully.
A maelstrom of children.
Just picking up kids and chucking them. He is the final boss! No.
Nigga Dumble, nigga Dumbledore.
I think he was a good guy.
You are seeing him hurriedly move his beloved students out of the castle. It shakes and shivers to another scene where he is interrogating an adult male sitting in a chair. It shakes again, to which he looks like he's in an interview with a scrawny female with bug eyes and huge glasses. And you can just make out the words divination as it whooshes again. And he looks like he's at a funeral, but you can't make out who it's for.
Nice.
What do you do?
Well, I guess I could relay what I just saw to Gregory.
Don't have to. He doesn't owe you anything. And you don't owe him anything.
What are you doing over there?
This character talking. She's doing nothing! I'm sorry.
Well, I stuck my head in this fancy bowl type thing, and I saw visions of...
Wait, did I actually see you stick your whole head in there, or did you just look into it?
She glanced in.
Okay, because I wouldn't I wouldn't have tried to stop her if she was just looking at something. But if you were to dip your head into, like, silvery fluid, I'd be like,
So the pensieve is kind of a confusing contraption, because right. In order to see through it, you kind of have to look directly over it.
Yeah.
And which as you're trying to get a better view, like trying to look at a tiny movie screen, you kind of naturally edge closer.
Yeah.
So from your limited perception of her, it could look like she's trying to like make out with the pensieve fluid.
Yeah. So that's what I imagine. That's what I'd be like, what are you doing?
I think I saw visions of what happened while we were gone. But just, like, fleeting images. I can't be sure.
Some sort of, like, a crystal ball type of...
Yes, kind
future
of.
Future prophecy type deal.
Just little flashes of scenes that changed.
Oh, that's so
one
cool.
One after the other. And then I kind of explain what I
saw. Is that something that you should even be looking at?
No! It is not something she should be looking at!
I'm sorry, I have a curious nature.
This is definitely my fuddy-duddy, like, Gryffindor nature coming out right now. Like, you shouldn't be touching or looking at things in here.
You're right, I'm just, I get nervous and I fiddle-faddle.
That's okay. Most Hufflepuffs do.
What is that supposed to mean?
Sorry.
The door creaks open. And the tall, powerful... yet crippled form of Albus Percival Wolfred Brian Dumbledore enters his office.
Headmaster?
And he looks at you. And he looks at you. And he looks at the near corpse. Flicks his wand, and the cabinet closes instantly behind you. He flicks towards Sean, and the body lifts. He does a whooshing motion and a stretcher appears. The body very easily lays down and magical ropes tie him to the stretcher.
Oh, good call, sir.
He says, he puts up a finger and he's like dead serious this whole time.
Oh, yeah.
And he looks at both of you and says, why don't you have a seat?
I'd like that.
Is there a chair we can sit in?
He points to two chairs.
We're really tired, aren't
he
we?
He points to two chairs that are suddenly right in front of the fireplace.
I sit in the closest one to me.
I sit in the other one not on Gregory.
Before making his way around his giant desk, he will stand over the stretcher and examine Sean just a bit, and place two fingers on his neck, and then pull them back, look down, look across, and then make his way to his desk.
He is very near death.
Yes, he is. And he sits down, but not an immediate emergency, I dare say.
That's kind of, this is Jeff talking, that's kind of cold. Shit. Gregor
Your parents have been beside themselves for most of this year. We have not heard from you in months. And there have been search parties looking high and low for any clue of your whereabouts. And the only clue we had was from Franz, and he is not here. Where have you been?
It was an accident.
An accident?
I oh boy, when was that? The last time that there was a hide behind? Yeah. No, it wasn't. Oh, shoot, I can't remember. I think it was the smoke, right? This is me, Jenny, talking.
Okay.
I can't freaking remember at the moment. It was hide behind or smoke?
It was smoke that lured us to the room where we had to fight the shadows. And then there was the, like, illegal fireplace or whatever
right,
that Sean was using in another room that you were interested in that you...
You mean Briar.
Fell into. Oh, right.
All
right.
So I...
You mean Briar.
I explained that to him, that I thought by following the mysterious fire that I could... help put the fire out.
Because you mean to say that you jumped through what you believe to be likely a flu network fire in the middle of Hogwarts grounds?
Yes.
And without any thought of your own safety or thought to retrieve faculty, you jumped in.
I did. I am impulsive sometimes. It's a problem. I wanted to stop what was happening. I was upset that my friend had gone through so much due to so many things being set loose in the castle. I was tired of it. I was curious, and I just jumped in, and my friend followed, and he wouldn't have my friends followed, Gregory and Franz, and they probably wouldn't have done that if I hadn't done that. So it's my fault that we got stuck where we got stuck.
I was concerned for her safety.
When we came out the other end. At the Time Loop Manor.
It is admirable of you to confess to your own guilt. Would you both like some pumpkin juice?
Yes.
Yes, please.
He just flicks his wand in sort of a lazy manner over his shoulder. And there's a crack, and they appear next to a little table next to you, which was certainly not there before. You have pumpkin juice.
Can John have some water?
You look down and he already has water.
Oh, okay. Thank you. He found
like,
us.
Damn, Dumbledore's good.
He found me. I don't know how long it took him, but he found me.
Yes, he was the final clue.
Good baby.
Let me give you a bit of perspective. The last night that we saw you, no, the last morning that we saw you, Professor Thrawnby saw you in her potions lesson. God rest her soul.
Mm-hmm.
And she informed faculty that you had made your way after feeling distressed, Gregory, that you insisted that you could smell smoke.
Yes.
And then we could not find any of you. We looked all throughout the castle, secret passages, behind portraits, every level, many times. Your friends could not find you. The prefects had no clue. You were not within the grounds. You were not in Hagrid's hut. You were not in the woods. We wondered if you had been kidnapped. But there was never any call for a ransom. Your parents had not been contacted by any force of Ministry or Death Eater or anything in between. For all we knew, you had simply disappeared into thin air. However, upon further investigation of your belongings, forgive me, we found something in Franz's bed. And then, near Thanksgiving, John took off, and we could not find him either. And I believed that he finally lost patience with waiting for you and went searching for you.
He did.
But that breed of cat does not behave recklessly. If he had a feeling that you were still alive somewhere, he would have gone to you. If not, he would have found loyalty in another person here, most likely. But he knew somehow that you were somewhere, and so he went to you. And based on how he is right now, it took him a very long time. He will open his desk.
Good boy.
And pull out a folded piece of paper and open it. And he says, admittedly, I do not know how to read this. It took quite a bit of time to actually understand. You will notice that it is in Swedish. Not in real life.
Oh, it's gonna be like, good, because I did not learn very much when I was
it's
there.
It's Swedish.
This looks English.
Yes. Swedish and English are very similar.
Oh, cool. Which I need to read it out loud.
The letters do not do what they're supposed to do.
If you do not, then I will, after you read it first.
Franz, this isn't going to make sense, but you need to listen, or else your friends' lives are in danger, and you will never learn why the centaur in the forest was so afraid of you. Oh. In this book, read the passage about the Jade Wizard. I've earmarked it for you. Later today, follow Gregory through the fire, keep them safe. You have lost them before. The house has answers you must find on your own. You are more than you believe. Use your gifts. It is no longer time to hide them.
No problems.
This is what you must do. Let Erin go through the house first. Listen closely to what she finds upstairs. In one of the upper bedrooms, the one with mirrors, find the hidden doorway in the left wall. Take one of the time turners. Reach the top of the house. Battle is inevitable. Only use your grandpa's spells. When the imposter is beaten, break open the staff and take what is inside. Use the provided flu powder to send Gregory and Erin back to Hogwarts. Slip the time turner into Gregory's pocket before he goes. Stay in the house. Await more instructions. You will know you are on the right track if these events occur. Erin comes back out of the house through one of the upper windows. The house elves summon the monsters. You see someone in the greenhouse out back. The imposter will let you listen to the prophecy. And darkness dies with love, time, and deafening sound. Finally, Gregory will interrupt your attempt to explain what you have done. Leave this letter where you found it. If done correctly, this letter will be given to Gregory and Erin. They must understand what we have done. They must survive. This will make sense soon. Our blood runs green. Franz Istvaan. P.S. Rip off the bottom of this page and wrap it around the time turner.
Wow.
So many cool things, because you literally explained things during the manor situation in which Franz did that didn't make sense at the time but do now.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Wow.
Thank you.
I checked my pocket.
It was really hard.
Yeah.
Does that mean that
so I imagine so.
Does that mean I left the jade wand with him?
You did not.
Mm.
However, when you put, look at, when you hear that and go, oh yeah, this, what the crap?
Yeah.
He it's took not that there anymore.
And slipped a time turner into my pocket.
Okay, then I'll take that out of my inventory.
I trust in my friend's abilities, and I reach in expecting to feel something.
You find a necklace, at which at the end is a pendant, circular, flat, and within is an hourglass. Its sand is the same color of the white blue of the time magic. And around the chain is this.
Is that? No, okay, I'm sorry.
Ah.
Also in Swedish?
This is in English.
Okay.
And written in a different ink, as if it was more recent.
Gregory and Aaron... I'm sorry, should I do a Swedish accent for this? Yeah, Gregory and Aaron...
Don't do that.
Sorry. I'm sorry I couldn't explain more. It's okay, Fred. You need to return to before the imposter could begin. Stop him. Please, please, stay safe. Mm-hmm. Do not come back for me. Do not look for me. I love you, Franz. We need to go return to before the imposter could begin.
Dumbledore
do you know who the
stand.
Imposter is?
Dumbledore will stand and say the final piece. I imagine... Mr. Thornwood is the imposter?
Yes.
Perhaps it is time for you to explain, then. What have you learned in this house and time loop that you have experienced?
Franz is a more gifted wizard than he lets on. To start, I believe he stayed behind because he had lost someone near and dear to him earlier in his life, his grandfather. His name was Enric. Enric apparently went missing earlier in his childhood, and we discovered. How he died, and we discovered his corpse held in a time magic bubble, for lack of a better term, Headmaster.
So you mean to say that... You mean to say that your friend is the Jade Wizard, then?
If he is potentially.
If he is able to control time magic, that is really the only explanation.
And he was
strong.
All kinds of things that we've never seen him before. Very powerful.
It was Sean, though. Sean was the one who was doing the time magic, and he had at least three time turners.
Yes.
We did, but we
if, for instance, there was time manipulation occurring in this house that you were exploring for months.
7 months.
7 months. If there was time manipulation occurring, did Mr. Thornwood say anything about creating said time manipulation at any point?
I don't believe so.
Because there is a possibility.
It was implied, but he was doing a lot of taking credit for things that...
That's true. He was taking a lot of credit for things.
He
did.
He was the Jade Wizard.
He thought he was the Jade
Super
Wizard.
Super cool and awesome.
He did think he was the Jade Wizard.
I don't think he was the Jade
and
Wizard.
And he actually appeared to be visibly very frustrated at the loop. Like, with all the different iterations.
And us, yeah.
Yeah.
Would you happen to know, and by this point he's actually standing and, like, approaching the person on the stretcher, would you happen to know if your friend Franz and Mr. Thornwood are related in any way?
Yes, we think they're half-brothers.
That's it, then.
By the grandfather.
Mm-hmm.
I am not... by any means an expert in the Jade Wizard whatsoever. However, from what I know or believe, is that the Jade Wizard is consciously aware when he passes his power.
Yes.
And therefore, if Franz's grandfather had a willingness to pass on the mantle of the Jade Wizard to Franz himself rather than Sean, then it is so. And if Sean never knew this, he could have assumed that it passed down to him instead.
I believe
that makes a lot of sense.
We interrogated Sean about the passing of the Jade Wizard's abilities, and he seemed to know about it. He could have been lying to put up a facade, but he did at least claim to know.
Because the reason this is important is that Franz is instructing you to use the time turner that he slipped in your pocket.
Right.
In order to return to the past.
Yes.
Which is breaking wizarding law. He is asking you to break the law of time. And that is important to know because none of us in this room have all the facts. And even if we were to wake up Mr. Thornwood right now, we will not know if his information is even valid.
It's true.
Meaning, your next step, and I'm sorry to say, your adventure is not done. Your next step is based on faith.
Is there some type of, like, truth spell that we can cast on Sean?
The thing is that even if we had a bottle of Veritaserum, which I am not saying we do, the truth is subjective to what we know. If I thoroughly believe that I am an enormous pink arumpant, then I will tell you that I am.
Okay. Yeah. So we need to find out if Franz is truly the Jade Wizard?
I don't believe Franz is reachable anymore.
Right.
If the time loop was not successfully stopped, and he is no longer here, but is there, he may no longer be of this time any longer.
True. I will explain the giant silver, almost a disco ball-like device hanging in the final room of our battle with Sean.
We kind of
and
tried to destroy.
Explain how we very badly damaged it, and the room seemed to stretch away from us before leaving.
Yeah, that was creepy.
It was.
The fact that you are standing here, talking with me, drinking your pumpkin juice, I hope. You are... Thank you. There's some Himalayan salt in yours for you.
Thank you. I was actually going to say I put Himalayan salt in it earlier, but I was like, I don't have any.
I've actually missed Himalayan salt mentionings.
The fact that you are here discussing this with me so candidly, the fact that you are alive at all, is significant because, for one thing, according to Franz's note, you have not survived the journey before.
Yep.
And
he's killed us over and over again.
It means that you defied logic by defying time, which is not something I've ever heard before. Time magic, the very usage of it, is very, very fragile. And I'm sorry, Gregory, but your father has a very precarious job. He could be knocked out of existence without any of us ever knowing. There are theories abound that say that there have been hundreds of wizards and witches that we will never know their name because they have been successfully wiped from our knowledge due to time magic.
I don't like that.
Entire wars could have been forgotten in an instant. And that is what time magic is. It is not simply changing the hour of the day. It is changing what is.
I will explain that there was one iteration that was unique based on the letter. And Sean was even thrown off by it.
What is that?
Just the occurrences that happened in that one iteration. Like
John showing up.
John showing up and Franz having a backbone, as Sean described it.
I also mentioned what he wanted to do in his endgame, like the genocide.
Yeah.
Thing.
We were kind of saving the really bad stuff for
reality.
Last. Yeah.
Upon this knowledge of Sean's goals, he will be silent for a moment. And you can't quite make out his face from where he's standing, but you imagine that he is, like, glaring thunder down at this person, who's effectively not even a student because of his age.
I would like to say something as Gregory.
Oh, yeah.
The way that Sean was speaking didn't sit right, and I believe that Sean was not only under the impression that he was more powerful than he was, but that the power had really gotten to his head, because he wasn't the same Sean that I had known in the past. What he's done is unforgivable, but even the most unforgivable things or people have some type of redeeming value. I don't wish him dead.
I am certainly not going to kill a past student. He has successfully murdered no fewer than 37 Slytherins in the last 7 months.
No. Is that what's been happening while we've been gone?
Yes. And we found them all.
No.
Just yesterday evening.
Was it the hide behinds?
No. It was a variety of methods. Often poison. Some seem to have gone through battle.
Where's Briar?
Briar is gone.
Like, dead gone or gone?
He was not among the dead.
That's who Sean was impersonating when we first came upon him.
There is something that you should know about Briar's family. His parents are prominent Death Eaters. You probably know this already.
Yes.
It is believed that multiple families that have been affected by the Death Eaters have lost family members because of the Canes. Briar is not a popular commodity in this castle.
Right.
And it is likely that Sean believes that his own family has been deeply affected by the Canes themselves. Why on earth he... Oh, I see.
I don't think he was like them.
Likely it was a defense, just in case you escaped. If Sean is a metamorph magus, and he's going to jump to that conclusion...
Mm-hmm.
If he is a metamorph magus and could impersonate anyone, the fact that he chose to impersonate Briar Kane is a very defensive move. Because if you managed to get away, he could have given you the impression that the true murderer was Briar himself.
Yes.
And he could get away with all of it.
Yes. It makes sense that he would turn into him. I'd also like to point out that Franz was certain that he was a metamorph mage.
Yes.
In the time loop.
He will gesture to Sean's face and say, a metamorph magus is a very... Well, it is very similar to an animagus, Aaron. In the sense that they can change nearly anything about their appearance. Not animal, but they can change their gender, their height, their weight, their voice. But not memory. They cannot adopt memory.
Right.
Only behaviors and visage.
The cap is by your feet.
What?
Ben Cap.
The cap.
But I'm listening, sorry.
I will retrieve it soon.
Okay. That's what I get for fiddle-faddling.
How dare you fiddle-faddle?
Here is an observation.
So sorry. That was not Aaron. That was Jay. Aaron will not burp in Dumbledore's office, just to put that out there.
Briar chose to stay behind. And that is his choice. And he chose to listen to the letter that was left for him, apparently by himself. Correct?
Excuse me, you're talking about Briar?
Franz.
Okay, you said Briar.
I
was really confused.
I was like, oh shit, what did Briar's letter say?
I apologize.
Okay.
So yes, Franz decided to stay behind.
Is signed by himself.
Yes, it is.
Meaning, Franz somehow communicated with himself.
Yes.
Meaning?
You can't do that, I thought, with time.
He had
you
access.
Shouldn't.
It would make you go crazy.
Yeah, he had access to Time Turner, and he's powerful enough to understand as the Drake Wizard. He's powerful enough to understand that that was a future self communicating with a past self.
Fuck. Franz.
Meaning Franz has more control over time than perhaps Mr. Thornwood did. Or he's being more risky with it.
He also...
this isn't good.
It's potentially risky. He wasn't himself the past, I'm gonna say, like, couple weeks before the time loop. I've noticed a change in his personality.
He wasn't wanting to share what he was reading in books, and that makes a lot of sense now.
It does. He was even reluctant to show us
the... pushy, annoying friends.
He was even reluctant to show us the Jade Wizard passage in a book that was earmarked.
If Franz believed that his secrecy would save your life, I'm sure you understand. Must
have. Yes, yes.
Of course.
I don't blame him at all.
No.
The fact that we're here is incredible.
However, with a past Franz communicating with yours, it pulls into question, does that past Franz still exist, since his timeline now no longer exists because yours saved you? It is a complicated query, and I do not expect a response, but we have one anyway. Yes, in the back?
I am willing to bet. Well, there's actually a lot of possibilities, never mind. It's barely even worth discussing.
The reason this is important is because... possibilities. There could be multiples of Franz walking around at any time with any given purpose. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately... if he has accepted his belief in his destiny as the Jade Wizard, he could be anywhere at any time and believe anything. He could appear in front of you right now and not understand why you are alive. Time magic is uncontrollable, except apparently by one. And we are hoping that Franz is correct, that he is that one. Now, I have a request.
I do too.
Yours first.
I would like to know why Hogwarts was recently evacuated for mass apparition. I tried asking
37 Mr. Dippet. Dead.
Yeah, right. It's Slytherins.
Right. Was there anything more specific, or was it just the protective measure of the fact that 37 students were killed?
All of them were Slytherin.
Right.
The fact that we did not know that so many were gone is baffling, because none of them were reported missing. Teachers did not recognize that they were missing students. They were a variety of ages, of genders, of skill, and talent. And I do not know how that is possible. And it is frightening.
I was just wondering that.
We have to go back and prevent that from happening.
Right. Is there some way that that all of House Slytherin could just be under some type of a spell to where they don't even realize that
it is
people
possible.
Are missing?
But if there is a spell that had such power, it can only start at one source.
Right. Oh my goodness gracious.
So no bodies have been found then?
The 37 bodies
They're
were
found
on campus.
Right. Oh, that's awful.
Were the 37 dead over the course of 7 months, or within a much more strict timeline?
Over the 7 months, based on the decomposition of the bodies.
I imagine that going back to before the imposter could begin, as the note says, would be before that 7 month mark. I don't know exactly when the imposter began.
Well, then we could do school over again. That'd
so...
be nice.
That would be nice.
My
so
owls!
I don't know the exact point in time in which Franz necessarily wants us to go back to. Or even if we should.
Here's what I will say in response. You pulled an excellent question about past selves seeing your present, your future seeing your past. And no, it should never be that way. You should never see another you. Because the moment you see this, it creates a time paradox. And whether or not a human mind can accept such a situation is not up for debate. That being said, if you were to return to the past to try and fix what has happened to my time, the only time you can return to safely is the time that you vacated, the last week of October, because you weren't here.
We go back to before we smelled the smoke, basically.
The day you missed.
I am particularly uncomfortable going back in time. I wish, at the very, very least, to speak with my father, not only to inform him that I'm alive and not missing anymore, but also any tips and tricks or advice to use the time turners. I want to be as safe as possible if we were to venture into that time warping journey.
I don't know that we have time for that, though.
It is a matter of debate, because you may return to that time at any time. However, Hogwarts is on the verge of a siege. With 37 Slytherins dead, that is 37 sets of parents who are now missing their children. And most of them, unfortunately, are with he who must not be named.
Oh. Yeah, that's a problem.
Hence why the evacuation.
So we should, That's,
Was the 37 bodies, realized and discovered, like, corpses and stuff, were they all discovered and brought to everyone's attention in the same day? I'm guessing, like, today? Or was it like, oh, we're suddenly aware of 10 dead, and then 15 dead, and
all,
then
all
few
at one
dead?
Time. All at one time. However, it was a student who came across them, and therefore, students being students, rumors, gossip,
yeah.
It is our legal obligation as a school to inform the parents.
Right.
And so we did so.
Now they're all going to come here and...
But that was for the best.
Big fight.
You don't ever want to leave parents in question.
Because of that, I think time is kind of short for doing this whole thing.
Well,
if it is your wish to speak with your parents before departing, you may. I am your headmaster, but I am not... I am not the deciders of your fate. But to my request, he will actually be misty-eyed when he says this. Please do this. Please save them.
See my parents, because I feel like they'll just try to talk me out of it or something. You know, like, if we do this and hopefully it does work, I won't need to talk to them. Because I can after. Oh god, I don't know. What a choice.
Perhaps it is best that we don't see them.
Yeah. I mean, time stuff, right?
I don't even know if Father would have any tricks to say.
I might try to talk you out of it, too.
It would also be cruel to show up in their lives suddenly, after they've accepted us being missing for 7 months.
Right. Instead, we could just go, and either it's fixed and everything's happy, or it's not, and things stay the same.
Do we need to go to where we want to be when we go back in time? Do we need to go to the classroom?
Yes.
And I imagine this necklace needs to go over both of us?
Yes.
And how many turns? I notice it turns.
I can instruct you. However, if you would like to see your father, I'm sure that he could also lend a hand.
I wonder if he can come with. It is his job.
It's true. But
are you able to apparate? Here?
Within the grounds, yes. Where would you like to go?
Do I know where my father would be in this instance?
No, unfortunately, no.
Do I know, like, time of day? Like, would he be working or would he be home?
He would be either near the end of his shift or at home.
Oh, crap. Should I come with you?
Yes. Okay. Break a fourth wall? Yes. Do not break party right now.
Would Mother be home?
What time is it?
It is around 6 o'clock at night.
Oh.
I take back my hand. And I say, actually, after we go back in time, at least for me, I don't know how you feel, but I want you to send an owl to my family and explain the situation, omit parts that you don't wish to disclose, but let them know that I've come back and that I'll be gone for a little while longer.
I will do so.
Me too.
I will do so.
Probably the best thing we could do in this situation. I'm trying
to think.
If you are successful, that notion will not even be needed. Because this instance will not have ever happened.
That was my thought.
However,
true.
In case you fail,
then the letter would be necessary.
Yes.
Could you explain that in the letter?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Are you ready?
You need to accompany us?
I will. Probably best, considering there may be Death Eaters on our doorstep.
Right. Lead the way, Headmaster.
But what about this... Oh, I see. Sorry.
I believe Sean Thornwood.
Forgive me. It does not matter what happens to him now.
I was literally just about to say it is completely inconsequential. Took the words right out of my mouth, basically.
Hear that, Sean?
Which explains a bit of his coldness. And the fact that he's responsible for 37 murders of his own students.
I mean, I thought he was a prick. I had no idea.
Alright.
It's a very Slytherin thing for a Gryffindor to do. Right, Gregory doesn't say that. I'm sorry, that was Jeff talking. But Gregory would say it's a very cowardly thing for a Gryffindor to do.
Perhaps I think this at times we sort our students too early.
Mm. Ooh.
Yes.
Could be. What a fucking statement, Dumbledore. Jeff talking.
Also something that Dumbledore says in Book 7. I'm quoting the book. Mm-hmm.
Does he say that?
I know the series way too well. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, he does.
Soft brag, but yeah. He says it to Snape in passing during one of Snape's memories.
Oh, gosh. I still like Snape's memory chapter.
That would make sense in that chapter.
Yep.
I forget what it's called.
Cool. It's just like Snape's
Prince
memory or something.
He will silently gesture to John, indicating for you to pick him up.
Yes, he must. Where I go, you go.
Also, just for my own peace of mind, I'm going to say this out loud. You cast Accio successfully back in the manor a couple episodes ago, and I told you that Franz had the flu powder the whole time, so just in case there was like a, why didn't it summon the flu powder that was there in front of me? The answer is because, and you would recognize this, having the teaching that you do, the little pouch was made of moleskin, and that skin cannot be manipulated by magic. It cannot be summoned or harmed in any way, and it can only be opened by those allowing it to open.
Very nice.
Thank you.
When I was hearing the thump, though, was that actual blue powder somewhere
actual
else
blue
that
powder.
We just couldn't find out? Okay.
That's really funny.
It was actually in the bedroom that you guys skipped right past.
Hmm.
Also, there was a Lethifold hovering around the manor that you guys, if you had slept, not rested, but because you rested twice, if you had slept at any point, it would have tried to eat one of you.
Oh, fuck.
Yeah.
Cool.
I know. But, good point.
I like to believe that one of us would have kept watch and we would have done that in turns.
No. I would like to believe that.
Fuck.
All right.
All right.
You make your way out of his office. The portraits were silent the entire time listening to the story, listening to the conversation.
I still have dragon hat gloves from the manor, right?
Cool. You do.
Thanks, portraits.
Along the way, he even summons platters of food for you to snack on along the way.
Oh, thank God.
There is no danger. There is no threat. No spells cast your way. No screaming. No blood. No time turners. And for just a moment, as you're making your way through the halls, you're deep breathing and smelling your home, smelling the castle. You are at peace. Before suddenly you have to remind yourself, you are not safe. And you are about to leave again into uncertainty to save the lives of people you do not know, because this is the path that you've chosen.
Well, maybe one we know, but we don't know.
I would like to, before we reach our destination to do the time turning, I would like to pull out the jade amulet on the silver cross or iron cross and give it to Dumbledore.
Can't call it that.
And say, we found this in the manor. I have no idea what it does, but it might be of some significance.
Are you sure you would like to give it to me, knowing that you are about to do something much more pervasive to the timeline? It may come in handy on your end more than mine.
Are you able to assess its quality?
Considering that its heart is made of pure jade, it may do something to jade magic or to time magic. It is unknown to me. It is not magic that I can control.
It is magical, then. I am going to put it on and equip it. Just to see if it has some type of an effect on me before I go through the time turner and possibly lose it or try to assess what it does in a more precarious situation. But while I have Dumbledore next to me, I feel safe to do this. Do I notice any differences when I put it on?
There is a slight hum in your magical aura, but beyond that, you cannot really tell. He looks at it as it rests against your chest, and he will quote something that sounds roughly familiar to you from one of your guys' lessons years ago. And he says, "Raw forces of nature have long been our companion. Some say they are the only forces that truly understand our kind. Jade is one of those raw elements that we have tried to use for as long as we have had wands. And ironically, it is one of the most rare, but also one of the most chaotic sources of magic. So much so that we have never been able to control it, except for one family and one person at a time. Do be careful with the pendant. But I do believe it is better with you than me."
That would make sense. Okay, I just made the adjustments on my character sheet.
He reaches into his cloak, pulls out small little bags, and he's like, "I had meant to give these to some students before they left, but no point in that now." So he'll hand you a little bag of lemon drops.
Oh, thank you.
And he'll hand you a bag of butterscotch candies.
Thank you very much, Headmaster.
Do these have any magical qualities?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
They grant you 1d8 plus 3 MP regain.
Per candy?
It's like a one-use thing.
It's a one-use?
Yeah.
1d8 plus what?
1d8 plus 3 MP gain.
Wow.
Just gonna watch. Candy bag.
Dang, I have to think if I want one that in my belt or
use
my chocolate
dog. 1d8 plus 3 MP restoration.
Cool.
Cool. I put it on my belt along with my standard HP potion.
At this point, you will reach Professor Thrombey's classroom. And he will turn to you. And you feel like you are ghosts within a cemetery.
Mm-hmm.
The lighting is off. It's more red than it was in daylight. It's dark. And there's like a very vague echo of students laughing and moving around, but no one's there.
What happened to Professor Thornby? No. We didn't ask that.
You may know.
I do.
It seemed... Okay.
What? What's that? Tell me. Please tell me. You're going to kill me.
This is Jeff talking.
Okay, yeah.
It seemed like a sensitive subject.
Oh, okay. You may ask.
Well, it probably is, but Aaron struggles with sensitivity.
Okay.
At all. Okay. Doesn't mean to, but yeah. What do you call that? Socially awkward? Yeah.
By the way, the description that you gave of past, you know, conversations and students playing and like echoes of like a class going on and stuff, I know that feeling, and you like described it really, really fucking well.
Thank you.
It made me happy.
He will turn to you and he'll see, I'll save you from it, he will see you looking at the door to potions class, and he will answer your unspoken question.
Ooh.
And he will say, Professor Thrombey suffered a heart attack near Christmas.
No.
Her husband followed soon after.
Oh, no.
Professor Shala suffered a seizure after giving one final tarot card reading to a student and did not wake back up. There has been a significant amount of loss in this castle this year. You cannot save everyone. Do what you can. And if you need me, tell me this message. For the greater good. And tell me that you have traveled through time.
Ooh.
And I will do what I can.
We'll do, Headmaster. For the greater good.
Don't like that.
Well, it's, yeah. It's basically Dumbledore's way of saying, past Dumbledore will respect the fact that students are coming at him saying for the greater good, which is obviously some type of password for him, and that time travel is a very big deal, and whatever we tell him is urgent.
Right.
Only people who have known me during the darkest time of my life know what that means.
Yep. We would not know that.
No, you would not.
No.
Time. I love, sorry to be meta.
Yeah, go for it.
How they gave us little hints that Dumbledore's totally played with time magic. And, like, I don't know, like, has some sort of understanding and, like, power.
He has understanding without ever explaining
it's
how
wild.
He knows. Yeah.
Like, I don't know what it is, but that's something to do with the Sorcerer's Stone.
It's cool, though. I like it.
It's cool. Anyway.
I guess one of the popular theories, this is also breaking away, but one of the popular theories before Book 5 came out, because there was a more significant lull, if you guys remember, when Goblet of Fire came out, she took longer to bring out Phoenix.
Yep.
And it was like, okay, where's the fifth book? God damn it.
Yeah.
So it was longer for people to create theories of what 4 had taught us and what was coming. And then what we got was an emotional rampage. One of the most popular theories that quickly got smashed as soon as Book 5 came out was that Dumbledore was a time-traveling Ron.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
that was a really popular theory back then. But because of how Dumbledore acted in Book 5, it's impossible that it would be Ron. So, yeah. Anyway.
It's cool.
You guys, look up at your headmaster. There are stars in his eyes as he's looking down at the two of you. And he doesn't say it, but there is significant gratitude because he knows what he is sending you back into. You will be alone, and you cannot ask Franz for help because he won't be there. He will take the time turner from you and wrap the chain around Aaron's neck and around yours and tell you 23 times.
It's 23 full turns or half turns?
Full turns.
Oh, fuck.
23.
Aaron does not say fuck.
And I urge you to resist the temptation to use this device again.
I don't like using it, don't worry. But, it's not gonna happen.
But do not lose it.
I'm not that impulsive.
Let's say I do lose it. Would there be some type of a protocol to follow?
I'm sure there is.
That's a good
if
question.
Things go well, despite losing a time turner, ask your father. However, I would much rather hear that you had destroyed a time turner than lost one.
Yeah, it's a big bad.
That's good to know.
Yeah, if it falls into the wrong hands type of thing.
Yeah. Okay.
In the distance, you hear the rumbling of voices and as if boulders are raining from the sky.
Oh, God.
Dumbledore does not look perturbed.
I wonder if it's Voldy coming.
No, he knows that it's the castle defenses. That's funny. And also, it plays into how much, like, how focused he is on our quest, per se. Like,
and
it's important, you know.
Dumbledore.
It's fucking Dumbledore, I am seeing. It's fucking Dumby.
Dumby.
It would be one movie.
I want to make sure that I'm not forgetting anything before we actually turn this thing 23 times.
I know, me too.
23 whole turns, right?
23 whole turns.
Jesus.
They want to do 23 and a half. Just in case.
And he doesn't lose wings.
May avoid a slight gap in your attendance to some classes. The fewer questions you have to answer, the better.
I do have a question. When we go back, are we going to see ourselves?
You may, for a moment.
We need to avoid that.
Avoid them.
If we can.
Okay. So we need to be able to save those 37 lives without encountering us. Do you think... Well, no, Franz wouldn't be there.
I believe Franz will be there up until the moment that the three of you go through the flu network.
Do we look different?
No.
Changed at all?
You look exactly the way I last saw you on Halloween night.
Is it okay if we interact with Franz?
No. I would avoid it. Because Franz was under strict instruction to himself to obey a strict rule.
Okay.
And he obeyed to the T.
Okay. If I don't come back, or if we don't come back, and we fail, it was really nice to have you as my headmaster.
Yep.
Always an honor to be a teacher to any child.
I'm gonna make you the best dessert I could possibly muster.
I look forward to it. I am keen on lemon.
With Himalayan salt.
Delightful.
You could come visit my farm.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 23 and a half. You guys are hurled through time and space. You are going through like a funnel of lack of matter. there is a network of events that whoosh by you, lights of various colors that you're not quite sure are processed by your brain accurately. You feel as if you are moving and yet standing still, like on a roller coaster and yet an elevator, and yet you are in bed, but no, you're standing, you're moving, you are everywhere and nowhere at once. And you appear back exactly as you are, exhausted. Fearful. John is not in your arms.
No, why? Oh.
Your John is here somewhere.
Oh, okay. I thought you were saying you are John.
You are a cat.
Oh, man. It's the body switching episode.
No. You appear.
I have a quick question. I'm so sorry. You said exhausted, mentally exhausted.
Yes.
Okay. I was wondering if we were physically exhausted. Well, that would be interesting.
That's going to be a problem.
Okay. That's okay. Go ahead.
You arrive in daylight. It is just before lunchtime. The halls are empty. You see the spare paper, parchment, book, bag left by a student here and there.
Mm-hmm.
And you can hear in the background Professor Thronby asking a question about a potion. And you just like naturally turn to the side as if wanting to answer her question.
And I say, na, na, na.
And then you realize it's you answering that question. What do you do, guys?
I try to leave as stealthily as possible. I want to get out of... Okay, first we need to get out of line of sight.
Okay.
Of everyone that might recognize where we are currently, including ourselves. So I wish to leave, go down whatever corridor that would lead toward Slytherin House.
Are we wearing robes?
You are wearing patchy robes because they were kind of torn up during your time in the manor and through battle. You had your wrist broken, then rehealed. Defendo was cast. Banshee scratches.
Do
yeah.
They have like a hood portion?
Yes.
Okay, I put that on over my face.
Good thinking.
Yeah.
I whisper, and I want to head towards Slytherin House
now,
sooner than later.
Point of order.
It might be the last place that they would expect us to be.
Point of order.
That's true.
If you guys are to pull up hoods, the first thing you'll notice is, oh crap, we're still wearing this necklace together. Who's gonna take the time turner?
I do.
Yeah, no, I'm not.
You take the time turner.
That's all you, boy.
And roll it up nicely, put it in the same pocket in which Gregory had placed it, although this time it does not have a note attached to it.
No.
I have to use the bathroom. I know this
go
is
for it.
And yeah. Then I put it in my hood.
Yeah, go for it. I'll whisper sweet nothings to Jeffrey for the recording.
Oh my goodness gracious, I am loving this.
Oh, me too.
By the way, not to be a butt, but I need to pee as well, so when she comes back, I'm going to go pee. I'm actually struggling with how to save 37 Slytherin lives, personally. It's going through my head right now. However, Dumbledore did slip, pun intended, that students were slipped poison.
Mm-hmm. There's also, I'm going to break a little bit, there is a clue, knowing who is responsible for all this.
Oh yeah, there's, I got freaking okay. Ideas. It's just
because
that.
I pride myself in the fact that, like, you've told me, like, sometimes that, like, things were moving slow. I did all of that on purpose because all of it has been leading to effectively this.
Yes.
Because if you remember what I've dripped in, you'll get it. But if you don't, you can still do it. It's just maybe harder.
Yeah.
There is always an answer.
I'm thinking back to, like, the attack on Ravenclaw House with the hide behind.
And you were definitely after that.
Yeah. And the fact that
you were at House Witherspoon.
Yes.
House Witherspoon.
House Witherspoon. And I wonder if we should probably stay away from the event of us going through the flu network. I imagine we probably don't need to see ourselves going in there. That'd be odd. So I think, yeah, I think that should just happen without us intervening or watching in any way. Boy, would I like to chat with Seymour a bit.
He is around. He is still here. You did. You never got an answer as to why he was at the manor.
Yeah. I do really want to chat with Seymour, specifically for that reason, but also to try and get some Seymour serum, see if he has any on hand, because that might help us in our adventure here. So that's one stop that I do want to make. I'm also thinking about where Briar Kane was that day, like looking back, because I think he might be important, because I have a feeling that Briar Kane did do some personality shifts along the way. I'm actually wondering if all of her interactions with Briar Kane were actually genuinely Briar Kane or Sean Thornwood. So I do kind of want to see if I can find Briar to see if it's Sean, and I might even further want to see if he'd be slipping some information as Sean. Like if Sean like accidentally spilled too many beans as Briar, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. As a Broista, you would hate that, dude.
Oh yeah. What up, what up?
He's a doggy.
Yeah, he's a doggy. He is a doggy. And then it's obviously approaching Sean Thornton himself. And I can ask, like, really, like, cornering type of questions. But I can't disclose that I know too much, because then that could break the whole illusion or whatever. And, like, a paradox can happen or something like that. I could simply suggest that we go see Dumbledore immediately and say, for the greater good, we're back in time, yo. Like, a bunch of Slytherins are gonna die. Help us out, bro. That's always a possibility. I know that Briar was spending a lot of time in the library during the one episode when he was attacked by a book that could have potentially not been Briar, could have been Sean pretending to be Briar, looking up.
I think I may have broken Jeff.
There's just so many possibilities when time magic is at play.
Yeah, they chose to go
along
back
with
in time.
Along with disguises. Mind you.
Yeah.
Time magic and disguises.
Yeah.
That's like a double fuck you.
Yeah.
To Jeff's brain, at least.
I forgot to mention something that I said that I would elaborate on episodes ago, but I'm going to do it now.
Okay, cool.
Do you remember we started a session and I said how there's like literary rules and you should not surprise or trick your reader unless you gave them proper opportunity to see it coming?
If you're a good writer.
Right.
Okay. So, and then I told you I was so tempted to just drop you into a situation with no explanation as to how you got there, and I had to resist doing that.
Right.
What I was meaning was just dropping you in the manor and not explaining how you got there, and realizing that's not fair, and I wouldn't like that, so I really shouldn't. I should lead up to that.
That's good, yeah.
Yeah.
What'd I miss?
Anyway.
I need to pee. But also I was thinking out loud about all the possibilities and places that we can go.
I'm very interested to hear what you're thinking about the situation. Get out of here.
And don't pee
on my dog.
It would be more interesting if you were to tell him everything and see how many things line up and what's different. So I will leave and you can tell him without my presence.
Okay. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
You're such a cute fucking dog. He looked at me all offended.
Hey. He curled up next to Jeff and kind of looked at me like, is this okay?
Alright.
Oh man, I don't even know where to start other than the obvious choice if we want to see what Sean's doing and trying to tail him. But I also want to know what Briar's up to. And I feel bad because I should have been like more insistent with Dumbledore that I don't think that he's a bad person. I meant to, but like, there's a lot going on.
There's a lot going on.
So I'm surprised I remembered to ask and say as many things as I did.
Just in case you want an opportunity to read this, by the way. Because you listened to it, but you didn't get to read it.
Hee hee. That's why you asked how to spell my name.
Uh-huh.
Looking at. Oh, it's so crazy. He's still in there trying to figure out the mysteries of the house. I just wonder how long he'll be in there. Wow.
Green.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
A step on. Yeah, other than that, I don't really have any ideas. And maybe go to our common rooms too.
Okay.
Our bedrooms or something.
Okay, bye.
Okay.
Give me, since we're waiting on him now, give me a d20. Cunning check. Actually, this will be a willpower.
Oh, that's a big difference. In points of 16 plus 6 willpower.
You recall, now that you are back in this hallway outside of potions class, you remember, because you just look in that general direction, because you're heading that direction, getting out of sight. Oh, crap. I remember. It was right here that I joined Briar because he was being belittled by Sean. There was a communication of
right.
aggressive means
yeah.
that occurred out here just before potions class. And you were defending Briar because Sean was holding Briar's bag.
I remember that.
And what happened at the end of that?
He gave an ultimatum about, like, what to do with the bag. Like, either I can rifle through it or we can take it to Dumbledore or a teacher or something, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And what did Briar choose?
To take it to a teacher.
And yes.
I told him that he should. So did he actually do that or did... Do we need to find out? We do. We need to follow him there. He's probably trying to steal his hairs or something. Oh, wait, no. He's a metamorph magus. He wouldn't need to do that. Okay. But, still.
Hey, Briar, I'll let you off the hook if you give me, like, some fucking hairs, bro.
Or clothes or something. Anyway, he was stealing stuff from students.
Sorry, no, that was awkward.
That's so funny.
What's it's up? Not as awkward as you using the bathroom after I dropped a bomb in it. Sorry. I did say sorry, but, like, not as obviously as I could have.
There's spray in there. Do you use spray?
Sorry. I use the spray.
Thank you. Sorry. I'm sorry I have a medical problem.
It's okay.
All right. Would you like to share with Gregory this realization that you recall that he probably won't recall? Because you were part of it.
He asked me to recall that time.
Who's he?
The DM.
Oh, got it.
Tommy asked me to recall the time Fool that Briar was being belittled by Sean over shit in his bag. Remember that?
Yes.
Literal.
And he was being a pompous asshole. I really didn't like him. I never liked him. But there's an ultimatum about, well, excuse me, either I can rifle through this right here, excuse me, or we can take it to a teacher and they can do it.
Right.
And I was like, Briar, you should choose the second option, bro. And he did. So maybe we need to go watch that exchange again and follow them.
The exchange has already happened based on the time that it is right now.
Well, fuck.
But, that being said, you know what Briar chose, and therefore...
I know where they would have gone. To McGonagall.
Okay, let's go there.
Because I remember that interaction very well.
Oh, you do? Okay, great.
And it was McGonagall.
Cool.
I'm like 90% sure.
Cool.
How do you know that interaction so well?
Because it was poignant. And it's just stuck with me.
It was McGonagall, yeah.
I didn't remember that part.
That's okay. All right, guys.
And I pay attention.
Jenny, we're not going after you. All
right. Right.
All right, guys. What do you want to do?
Well, the inner...
If you want to end right now, we can. If you want to keep going, we can.
I kind of want to keep going. Hold on. It's been going for 1 hour and 41 minutes so far. It's pretty short. We had a late start. I don't have to wake up early, though. And I'm very intrigued. I want to get a little bit further
into this. But I'd like to get a little bit further along.
Yeah. Okay, so I know we have to try and think about it before we go there. We have to have some sort of, like, a goal. The interaction happened, so that means they're on their way or already at McGonagall's. They could have already been done with McGonagall. So,
let's go find out.
Yeah, I guess we're just hunting for information at this point. There's not necessarily a goal per se, except for just witness the exchange.
Right, we don't have time. The time.
I do share with you that I wish to speak to Seymour at some point. But for entirely different reasons.
Yeah. Okay. And I would dare tell you I wanted to try and talk to Briar.
That was one of my ideas.
At some point.
I wanted to try and talk to Briar to see if he's actually Briar or if he's Sean. But seeing as how the exchange happened... then Briar's probably Briar right now.
Yep, and then, like, obviously we're going to try and tell Sean as much as we can.
Okay. Let's go to McGonagall's.
Okay.
You guys head up.
Sneakily.
The three or four levels of the castle, out of the dungeons, into the entrance hall, up the spiral staircase, up, 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 to the Transfiguration Wing. And you arrive in the upper courtyard, and you're like, man, we're Hogwarts. So much nicer than a fucking time loop mansion. Dude.
Food is not expired. There are monsters everywhere. Well, I'm gonna forget that.
And as you approach the Transfiguration classroom, you can hear a class taking place inside.
Do we hear her?
McGonagall would certainly be in there.
Yeah, we hear her talking, probably.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. I was going to say... could have, like, a substitute temporarily or something.
This is Hogwarts. There's not, like, work leave.
Oh, I know. I'm just saying, like, she could have had someone else take over for a moment.
They don't get breaks.
I'm a werewolf. I need you to teach my class for a month. Week.
Either the exchange already happened, or they're on their way, or they're just... patiently waiting in the classroom or something. What would Sean do? Would he interrupt a class for this?
Probably. I think prefects are allowed to do that. Maybe we should wait for a little bit?
but out of sight.
I would like to... Yeah, I like the idea. Wait, out of sight.
Out of mind.
Okay. Give me cunning checks, guys.
Four.
Eight.
Oh, plus one.
You guys suck at hiding. Therefore, you pick the very public courtyard statue that shows the wizard with his wand pointing up and holding a tome that you're like, this is fine. And you sit by the statue and go, well, wait here, in full view of everything.
No, that's not good.
And you wait about 5 minutes for the bell to ring, knowing the signal for lunchtime. The doors clang open, and various offices are open, various classrooms are emptying of students. Nobody really cares that you're sitting there. No one.
Don't you love dice rolls?
That's good.
People emerge and they look around. They're like, oh, it's bright today. That's really cool. It's going to be winter soon. Oh, man, I can't wait for the Halloween feast. Yawn. And they just walk right by you and you're like, we're being sneaky. And they're like, don't care. It is around this time that you are remembering that was the same sound that you heard right before smelling the smoke. And you guys went upstairs to find the smoke. You also notice with that memory, guys, neither of you smell smoke.
Uh-oh. What does that mean?
We don't smell smoke currently. Yeah, but we're like more than just one level.
Correct.
We're like several levels up.
Correct.
And also the smoke. We're outside.
Correct.
So that's totally fine that we don't smell smoke.
Yeah, but like, are we too late? That shit's already happening. We're supposed to be stopping.
We're not supposed to be stopping us from going in.
Right. Okay.
Because this is such a real predicament, and I love it so much.
Yeah, because like, yeah, we don't want to stop us from going in there.
No, I didn't say that.
Like, yeah, we definitely need us or the old us to go through. Because if we didn't go through the whole time loop, then that would fuck everything up.
Not at all what I was thinking.
I was confused by...
Oh, yes. And as the students are leaving, you're noticing that it's a second year class. And as soon as like the final couple leave, the door stays open. And you do not hear the voices of Sean Thornwood or Briar Kane inside. Nor McGonagall.
Should we go ask McGonagall if somebody brought her a book bag? Or I don't know. God. We could.
We could approach with the intent... of being like concerned students. Be like, hey, we witnessed this thing happening, and Sean and Briar said that they would come and talk to you.
Yeah, I like that.
We can be all like, I'm really worried about what Briar had in his bag because he seemed really secretive, and I trust Sean's judgment, which would be completely believable. That's with true. Us being Gryffindors. Sorry. Us, as in me and Sean being Gryffindors.
He's excluding you.
Sorry. Jenny's a Gryffindor. Okay, let's do it.
So this is right.
Let's go walk closer and at least see if she's in there or not.
Okay, I like that. I'm gonna throw something out there. Maybe just the very fact that we hopped through time, someone perceived us being there without our knowledge, actually changed the fact that that fucking exchange between Sean and Briar happened, and changed the fact that we didn't follow the smoke smell or something. That'd be really crazy. That'd be some next level shit.
It's true.
Because we don't have any way of knowing that all that shit actually happened.
That's true, but however, like, if we want to do all the hypotheticals, we can sit here all day and do
if that. If we are successful in our quest, uh-huh, our current quest, we need to be successful in, so we need to assume that everything that needs to happen happened. So,
yeah,
if we assume that everything that needed to happen happened, that means that me, you, and Franz are no longer on the school except for me and you in our current state, because they all went through the fire.
Yeah.
So we don't have to worry about us running into our doppelgangers. Our time doppelgangers.
Yeah,
you
should still be careful, but anyway. But yeah.
Yeah. Go closer and see if McGonagall's there. She wouldn't be wondering why we were there, because it's lunch bell. So it's kind of like a freedom.
I want Jenny to lead this action.
Okay, I'm gonna go over there and like just like go closer and see if I can hear her in there without getting anywhere near the door, kind of.
You awkwardly do that like sidle into like the little like the archway of the classroom to peer in, but like I'm totally doing this naturally, kind of peek.
Yeah, that's character appropriate.
Give me a cunning check.
I almost gave myself another cunning. Oh, two plus one.
You fall.
Oh my god.
As you're trying to be all cunning.
I'm the worst person for this.
And she sees you because she's sitting at her desk in her classroom, and she calls out, Miss Lucas!
Great.
Is there a problem?
Yeah. Oh.
Is it your time of the month?
No.
I have pads in here for you if you like them.
Could they even do, like, wouldn't they just be magical pads?
I have magic napkins in here, boy!
Whoa, what if they're able to, like, do stuff to help? Oh my god. Okay, we better not start with that.
There's an incantation for that,
so you're not doing it. It's a magical IUD. Ah!
Oh! You said made of copper!
You said it wouldn't hurt!
My cervix!
It doesn't hurt!
It does hurt.
Tightening!
Okay, it causes you to cramp, so whatever. It's quite a bit.
One motion's got me.
Alright, I ask, Professor, have you possibly seen Sean or Briar in the last 15 minutes? Or even a whole class.
I just taught the second years. They're not in this class during that time.
All right. That's all.
Very good.
Yes, thank you. I think that's all. I don't
know what else to ask her. Shit. Okay, so you come out of the classroom?
Yeah, and I say no.
And now here's the question. Was that McGonagall or was that Sean?
What was that McSeanagall? All right. No, I'm sure that was McGonagall.
All right, guys.
So I catch up with her. Hold on.
All right, guys.
Hold on.
All right, listen.
Hold on.
The answer to this question.
The answer, of course, is onion.
Barcelona.
Barcelona. Oh, nope. Can't do any of that.
Is it possible that the exchange had to have happened? Is it possible that when he said we go to McGonagall's, that he was lying to Briar?
Yes, probably. Let's go to Slytherin Tower. God damn it.
Hold on.
Roll to
there
run.
There is no tower. It's for Slytherin.
Oh, Slytherin's dungeon.
Dungeon.
It's sorry.
A dungeon.
God it's a dungeon. It.
Where they rightfully belong. No, I'm kidding. If we have to get in Sean's head, he had lied about McGonagall and he escorted Briar to not McGonagall, where would he have gone?
Slytherin dungeon.
Would it have been the...
Or Professor... Who's
would
his,
it be the Slytherin head of house?
Right, Thornby, right? No.
Professor Thornby was the potions master, mistress.
Do we know who the Slytherin head of house is?
Professor Thornby.
Haha! Good job. For me. Let's go see Professor Thornby.
I think that might be a good idea.
Okay.
Alright, guys. You head back downstairs. Give me dex checks.
Sneakily. 13 plus 6.
6 plus 5 for 11.
You guys make your way downstairs and are heading down the spiral staircase. And something occurs to you. Now you can smell the smoke. And you are suddenly on the landing, which you know you ascended to in the previous time. Meaning, this is the hallway in which you guys eventually disappeared through. Dex check is how much noise you made on your way down. You passed, so that you just see the back of Franz as he casts Reducto on the Ashwinder at his feet and turns left to look through the doorway through the classroom. You guys know is the flu network. What I'm saying to you is that you are seeing your friend at the other end of this hallway. Your friend who knows nothing about what he is about to do.
He hasn't heard that yet?
You don't really know. But, based on the time that you guys went through, he likely has read that. Meaning, he knows what he has to do, but not quite what it means. Do you do anything?
No. You can't interact. Because Dumbledore said everything played out perfectly.
Sneaking,
and he was following it to his
sneaking team. Very sneakily.
I will say, to just pull at the heartstrings a little bit.
You see his
profile just for a couple of seconds as the flicker of green flame crosses his pale face, and he assertively goes forward as you can hear Gregory's voice say, "The Franz!" And then away.
Fuck.
And then, and there's no sound. Both of you get 2,000 experience.
Because
you role-played through that conversation with Dumbledore beautifully. You made a hard decision to not see your parents. You made the hard decision to go back in time, which was an active choice. Yeah. And I
was tempted to just not.
And you obeyed the rules of don't find yourselves, don't talk to Franz, try to sneak. So, great. 2,000.
Thank you.
I'm going to end session here because...
It's a good spot.
It's a good spot. You guys know that you're on a decent track.
Mm-hmm.
And you can kind of have a week to think, okay, what do we do? Because it's almost like restarting at another time, but you know so much more. Yeah. But really, are the odds in your favor?
There are so many things that we could do, but there's no way of convincing. That's the issue that's in my mind right now. Because it's like, part of me is like, yeah, just tell everyone, like, yeah, we came back
sure
in time.
Sure wish we were playing with Hermione. Okay.
It's like, yeah, we came back in time. Bunch of students of Slytherin House are in danger. Should probably protect them. There might be a spell cast on you, which makes you believe that they're not missing.
God. Thornby.
Thromby.
Thromby.
Then.
Some shit's about that.
Thornfields.
Thornwood. Thromby and Thornwood.
Eisenhower.
Anyway, ending session.
I like Ike.
wow, that's almost exactly 2 hours.
Bye-bye!
Bye, everybody.
Goodbye.
Bye.
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 Bye.